us to you, for protecting us always, for giving us your love. Open our hearts and our minds. Help us to take you in today. I pray this in your name. Amen. So one of the benefits of having a 30-minute commute here to St. Barnabas is that I've been able to listen to more books. I started to listen to books several years ago when I was training for a long run. I tried to just listen to music, or I tried to like not listen to anything, like, because I know some, like Kurt runs with just to listen to God. And I am not as good as Kurt. Because what would happen is I would just be running, making this long list of why I should stop running. And it wasn't doing me any good. And so I started listening to books because it kept me going. And it distracted me from making those lists of why I should quit. Well, one of the authors that I've really come to enjoy as I've been listening to books is Christopher Paul Curtis. He's a young adult author who writes historical fiction. My son Nathaniel and I went up to Minnesota back in February to visit my college daughter, and we listened to one that took place during the Great Depression. He loved it, and so I've been continuing to read Christopher Paul Curtis. I finished another one of his books a couple of weeks ago. It's called Elijah of Buxton. It takes place in the mid-1800s up in Canada. Buxton, Ontario, was a town that was established by a white pastor for escaped slaves from the United States. There's a wonderful scene in the middle of the book that reminded me about what the Christian community is supposed to be like. Since next week, we're welcoming new members here at St. Barnabas, and then at the second service today, we're baptizing Dante and Dee Dee. I thought I'd share that scene with you because that's what being a part of the church is all about. So here's a little background to the piece that I'm going to read to you. Mrs. Holton and her two daughters had made the dangerous trip to Canada after escaping from slavery. Her husband had also tried to escape, but he'd been recaptured along the way. Mrs. Holton hadn't heard any news from him until finally she received a letter. Elijah is the one who went to get that letter from the post office. Elijah is 11 years old. He was the first baby born free in that settlement of Buxton. Even though he has never seen the horrors of slavery, he has heard enough about them throughout his life. He knows that it's very rare to receive a letter that has good news in it. Most letters contain bad news. So when he realizes there's a letter from Mrs. Holton, and she's been waiting years to hear something from the United States, he knows that he needs to go tell his mom. He knows that he's going to need her help. He runs home and finds his mom in their garden. This is what happens. He says, "Mamas are some amazing and scary people. Seems like they got ways of seeing things that ain't showing and hearing things that ain't being said. I didn't even open my mouth, but Ma knowed by some mystery way that something weren't right. She quick stood up and said, 'Elijah, what's wrong?' The trowel she'd been using and a fistful of weeds fell out of her hand. 'What happened?' She ran up to me and I showed her the letter from America. I told her what was written on the envelope and she said, 'Oh no, 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 don't it ever. And I didn't waste no time.' She said, 'Go get your Sunday clothes, Elijah. We gonna go tell her together.' I changed my Sabbath school clothes and walked into the parlor. Ma had already put on her Sunday dress and was carrying that pie she'd baked. She said, 'Good thing I baked this here pie. I hate to go for something like this barehanded.' We started out toward Mrs. Holton's place. Miss Duncan the first and Miss Duncan the second were tending their flower garden out front of their home. Miss Duncan the first saw us and stood up and called, 'Sarah, what their skirts, and Miss Duncan the second said, "Hold on, we's coming with you." That poor, poor thing. By the time we got to Mrs. Holton's home, what started out with me and Ma and a letter had turned into a whole parade of people. There were 12 of us, me, 3 babies, and 8 women that were all carrying something to eat. There were pies and cornbread and chicken livers and ham and dandelion greens and grits. When we got there, Ma pushed me forward onto the stoop to knock. Mrs. Holton got up out of her chair. She smiled at me and said, "Why, hello, Elijah. My goodness, how come you's in your Sunday?" She opened the door, and her breath got stuck in her throat for a minute. When she saw the bunch on her stoop, she said, "Oh." She smiled at everyone and said, "Welcome. Y'all come on in. Can I offer y'all something?" Ma said, "Thank you kindly, Sister Holton, but Elijah done pick up a letter for you in Chatham. It from down home." Mrs. Holton told me, "Elijah, could you read it for me?" Miss Duncan the first put her hand on the rocking chair and said, "Why don't you get off your feet, Sister Holton?" "I'm fine, Miss Duncan, really I am, but thank you kindly. Elijah?" So as you can imagine, the news Elijah reads is not good. It's not the news Mrs. Holton had been waiting so long to hear. You'll have to read the book yourself if you want to know what it was. And I'll tell you, it's a good listen, really, if you start listening to books. You can download it from your local library. But here's what Elijah thought about that whole parade of neighbors who went to support Mrs. Holton that day. Once Ma and them women bunched up around Mrs. Holton with their watching, waiting eyes and hands, it felt like a whole slew of soldiers was ringing that parlor with swords drawn, and were no sorrow so powerful it could bust through. Once them women bunched up like that in Mrs. Holton's parlor, it seemed like they built a wall at Jericho around us, and 100 Joshuas and 1,000 children couldn't have knocked the wall down if they blew trumpets and shouted till their throats bust. That is what the Christian community at its best should look like. People who care, people who are ready to catch you if you start to fall, people who know just when to pick up a pie and bring you God's love. I have seen that here at St. Barnabas. I've seen you listen to each other's pain. I have heard you talk about the phone calls that you've made to each other as you've reached out to each other with support. I have seen the hugs you've exchanged as you've tried to hold each other up. Sadly, we all know that the Christian community doesn't always look like this. Plenty of slave owners claim to be Christians, but we know how they treated other human beings. We don't have to read too far into the headlines to find articles about abuses and scandals that have taken place in the church. When I went to get the paper out of the yard this morning, there was an article on the front page about that. And of course, we can think of times when we've experienced heartache and hurt in our own churches. This is why we need Jesus, the Good Shepherd. We can look to him and know that he will not leave us when times get hard. He will lead us to still waters and green pastures when we need rest. He will protect us from the wolves. He will fill in the gaps when we humans fall short. He will surround us with a wall of love that no sorrow could ever break through. And he will never stop working to bring us back into the community where we need to be. And so to Dee Dee and Dante, to Joe and Joey, to Katie and Mike,